Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
To our show, Dog is Family. It's a monthly show, and we talk about all the things in dogdom, all kinds of topics to keep our dogs healthy and happy with us at home and to keep them forever. My name is Barb Emmett. I am the host and the producer of the show, and it's going to be a wonderful show for you folks today, and I'm very, very, very excited to welcome Dr. Jamie Moran, a veterinarian practicing locally at Willow Creek Veterinary Hospital. And she has a wealth of information that we want to share with you. I want to introduce you, those that don't know her. I know there are many of you watching today that do go to Dr. Moran, and they were very excited to also hear you today on the show. And we're going to spend time exploring many topics. Let's go and introduce you to Dr. Jamie Moran.
Hello.
Hi, how are you today?
Hi, Barb. I'm good.
Good. I would love to read a little bit of your bio. Dr. Moran started, and just jump in anytime if you don't, but 1980, she graduated from Cornell Veterinary School, right?
Right.
And tell us about your early years after you graduated, your journey, because we really want to explore this. Dr. Jamie Moran is an integrative veterinarian. And she and I have talked terminology to help you understand what that's going to mean, and we'll be doing that. But journeys and stories of people who have been involved in animals, which is what we all love here in this show, is, I think, reflects just our journeys in learning. And she's got a great background to share with you. So lead us off from 1980s graduate times.
Okay. So after I graduated, I took a job in Collegeville as the resident vet for a dairy farm, Wallaby Farms. And so I took care of two herds, a Jersey herd and a Holstein herd. So I took care of them. You know, that was it. The reason I got there was because, I'll tell you how it morphed to get to Reading. But anyway, so that was my job. They had all these really valuable cattle, and they wanted a veterinarian right there. So I did everything. I did calvings, I did surgeries, I bred the cows. If I needed a cow, I went and got her, brought her down, put a whole halter on her. You know, and I did a lot of stuff, which a lot of veterinarians probably don't do because they have to, but it's good. It's really good. It was really good. So things were a little funny there. You know, it's a long story. So I decided I might moving on to another job. So I talked to Dwayne Kennedy, who was the person that used to do the work there at Wallaby. And I talked to him at a meeting one time at Cornell, and I asked him if they had any openings at Willow Creek. And he said, which at that time was a huge practice, and we did a lot of dairy and everything. So Dwayne said, yeah, let me see. So I left Wallaby and I moved to Reading, and I started at Willow Creek Vet Center, which was vet hospital back then. It was mostly, so I did a ton of dairy. I did large animals, small animals, a little bit of small, mostly large animal. And we did everything, you know, sheep, goats, pigs. And then when llamas started, I started being the llama person. And then I ended up being at Willow Creek, you know, for a long time. I took a little sojourn to Massachusetts, and I helped a friend of mine with her. Basically, it was an equine practice. We did horses and sheep and goats and things. Anyway, I did that for a couple of years and came back to Willow Creek. And I've been there ever since. And I would say I actually always wanted to do acupuncture, but I was a little bit, I was a little afraid to ask to do it, to tell you the truth. And I was giving a class for kids at my daughter's junior high school. And I was trying to help the girls like be empowered, you know, and use their voice and ask for what they wanted, and realize I wasn't asking for what I wanted. And I thought, you know, I got to walk the walk and talk the talk. So I asked my boss, I said, what do you think about me taking the acupuncture course? And she said, sure.
Right.
And all those years I didn't like do it. Yeah. So anyway, that was 2008. And the reason I did that is because I just started thinking when I started doing more small animal, I was in there doing that all the time. And I just felt like I was going round and round. A lot of things weren't getting better, or they were just coming back around over and over. And I just thought, you know, maybe there's other ways to treat things. And I just wanted to learn that. So in 2008, I took the acupuncture course at Qi Institute, which is down in Florida. And I did the I learned acupuncture was my intro drug. And in the class, I'm hearing people talking about homeopathy, and they're about hemoacupuncture, and oh my God, all these things I'd never heard about. They're talking about this and that. And I thought, I have just opened Pandora's box.
Yes.
Really. You know, yeah. So anyway, because there's so many different modalities, and a lot of the people that I was in class with were learning acupuncture, but they had already been doing a lot of other things. So anyway, so I took acupuncture class there, and then I did some of their herbal classes, some of in person, some online. I did their food therapy class, and I met somebody who I, you know, still really a lot part of my life. Her name is Connie DiNatale, Dr. DiNatale, and she's helped me over the years and with a lot of cases. And because, you know, I work in a practice with wonderful veterinarians, they're great. But when I ask them, you know, I can't really talk to them about herbs or acupuncture, because that's not like we share everything else, but they, you know, that's not their forte. Mm-hmm. So, but they're very supportive, really supportive.
And we need that. I think I have used the words integrative veterinary medicine because, of course, my journey's been that as well with my golden retrievers. And even recently last year with our golden retriever, Lake, we used an integrative protocol. And when I mention that to people, I see their eyes glaze over because they're like, what are you talking about? And we worked with our veterinary oncologist down in Hope at the center, as well as an integrative veterinarian I had been working with before I really was connecting with you. Yeah. And we put together a total package that both the Western conventional oncologist and my veterinarian, who does more holistic integration, we came up with the protocol. So I am always excited. And I just wanted to read you should I read the definition of integrative vet care? Would you like to give us like the difference between integration and holistic veterinarians and then Western? Can you kind of help people?
I can give you an idea. And you know, I read something last night and that I didn't really kind of agree with about a definition of holistic medicine. But anyway, so what most people in the world around where we are do is what we call Western medicine. And even in China, they do Western medicine, right?
Ah, yes.
Western medicine pretty much means regular, you know, surgery and using pharmaceuticals, mostly using pharmaceuticals and you know, the diagnostic, I guess you would maybe throw the diagnostic things in there too that we use. The treatments are using more pharmaceutical things. There's a lot of infiltration of nutraceuticals, which are foods and vitamins and things. And, you know, there's always been a kind of an overlap of that with Western medicine. It's not like, you know, like you get a B12 shot from your regular doctor. So mm-hmm. It's not like they don't pay any attention to any of those sorts of things. That's, that would be, you know, really, really unfair to you know, ask, you know, say that. But anyway, so that's kind of Western medicine. It's what you normally expect when you go into a regular veterinary clinic or your regular doctor. And integrative medicine, I think, to me, is when you start putting in things that are normally not found there. So that might be using herbs. It might be integrating ozone therapy or acupuncture or massage or, you know, a lot of other things. And physical therapy, I think, you know, and physical therapy is, we do physical therapy at Willow Creek, and it's part of our, you know, regular, you know, things that we offer people. So it's not outside the Western medicine box or whatever. I mean, it's hard. It's like anything. You try to, you know, put anything in a box and you get more exceptions than you get inclusions, really. But anyway, so integrative medicine to me is where you just choose what you, it's a bigger toolbox.
Yes, yes.
That's how I look at it. It's like,
yes,
when you go to kindergarten, you get the box of the 8 crayons. When we went, we got the 8 crayons. And then it's like, you can do a lot with 8 crayons, but when they give you the 162 crayon box, whoa. So like, you know, there are people that have a lot of crayon colors in their box, way more than I do, you know? So I think that's so that what you do is you choose the things that you think will fit the best for your patient and the things that will do the best good, cause the least harm. And you just have to, you know, the most important thing I think with medicine for anyone is that one size doesn't fit all.
Yes.
And I think to be holistic, you have to think about the patient as a whole. And you can be that no matter what your tools are that you use to treat them, you can treat a patient holistically. A lot of the doctors I work with, I think that they're holistic veterinarians, and they don't classify themselves as that, but they talk about food, they talk about environment, you know, because, so I think you have to look at your patient as a separate entity from everything else. And it, you know, and that they're different, but how they relate, you need to also know how they relate to all the other things in their environment in order to be a good doctor. And you can be a lousy holistic vet just using herbs, what we call allopathically, which is, you know, like, oh, I have a headache, I'm going to take ibuprofen. Or I have a headache, I'm going to take St. John's wort because it's the, or I'm depressed, so I'm going to take St. John's wort. You know, it's an herb, but you're using it as a, oh, you've got this, you take that. And it doesn't really work like that. And because, you know, most herbs, just like most drugs, are not one size fits all. You know, there's so many different ones. But the cool thing about herbs is if you make a mistake, it probably just won't work, you know. But St. John's wort's not a good example. You don't want to take that willy-nilly. It has a lot of herb-drug interactions. You've got to be careful. So does that?
Yeah, I think that's perfect. And I know for me, I've felt this for many years, integration. Actually, when I think about my journey, one of my goldens, 12 years ago, had an oral tumor. And here's where the defining line for me was. We were not going to do surgery. There was no chemo that could have attacked what was going on with that oral tumor. And there were no real drugs, which I wasn't after anyway. And when I said to myself, we need palliative care, we need alternative care. What are some things that can help and I can feel good about, and it'll give him maybe more time? So my journey started way back, but I felt kind of alone in that. And as that journey continued, you know, I would ideally love to go into a practice and integration and conventional Eastern and Western come together and go, here's the protocol, let's follow it. But I love how you've presented that. There's no one size fits all. The tools in the toolbox are bigger, and that's empowering to pet parents so that when they come in, and if they're not doing some, they've read, or they're not always doing the conventional path, they feel accepted perhaps and able to take more involvement. How do you see that?
Oh, yeah. And you know, the longer I do this, the more I understand all the crazy stuff. I shouldn't say crazy because it's great. Yeah. You know, they would come in with books and this and that and the other thing. And it's a lot of work, right? Part about this. I mean, my physician actually told me if he would really like to learn this, but it's really a deep learning curve, but it's cool. You know, I mean, learning is wonderful. So,
it is.
But yeah.
Can you take us, could we, okay. So I'm sitting here today or viewers at home and they're saying, oh my gosh, I want to have an appointment with Dr. Jamie Moran. Can you help people understand how that appointment may go with you with the tools that you have in your toolbox or how you approach that time spent with them? Can you walk us through the new client process at all?
Well, sure. I mean, I really think that it doesn't really matter it doesn't matter how you're going to treat them. That most of the stuff is the same, right? You have to get history. You want to find out, you know, what's going on. You get as much information as you can. I sometimes feel like a detective, you know. Well, I always tell people doctors are really detectives because you've got a mystery and yes. You're trying to solve the mystery. And you use, you know, your history, you get all those things. So an appointment, a holistic appointment, I like to have more time, but as my technicians, they all know, like I would probably take an hour with everybody if I could, but like, you can't, and yeah. I think our doctors probably would too, but I just, you know, cause there's so much you don't know. And particularly if it's a patient, you're just learning, meeting the first time. So you get a good history, you find out as much as you possibly can. And when someone, I really, really like that owners are involved. I don't mind that they've done Dr. Google. I really think you can learn a lot. I think as long as they've really looked into it a lot, they know a lot of things, you know, not just a one quick check. Anyway, and then now I know a lot more. So if they tell me something like I tried this, I'll say, oh, okay, that's good. Or no, that's not. And still there's so many things that I've never heard of or supplements they come with. But anyway, so we talk about you get a really good history. There are questions I ask that I never used to ask.
Okay.
You know, like I'll ask if they're hot or if they're cold or where they seek to go. Do they dream at night? There's a lot of things that I didn't really think about before I started to learn Chinese medicine because they're not anything that any Western practitioners that I know ever concern themselves with. I didn't. Now, it could be that there are some that do. They're, you know, that just have a different, you know, information gathering stuff that they do that every, you know, because I wouldn't want to generalize, but I know I didn't think about a lot of things. So my exam might be different or my history taking might be more like I might ask, do they drink a lot at once? Or they drink a little bit all day or do they just drink a ton at once? That means a little different. That's a little different. And that tells you something that you might plug into your Chinese diagnosis that I wouldn't normally ask. Mm-hmm. And then I do my normal physical exam, but I might pay more attention to the heat feels on them. You know, I might, and you look at, you know, in Chinese medicine, you use the tongue and the pulse to get a lot of information. And they're not that easy.
Yeah. You know,
if you see somebody like a Chinese, now people are easier than dogs, I think, for temperature or a tongue diagnosis. I mean, it's a lot you can learn from people's tongues. Dogs' tongues, I think you can learn something, maybe not quite as much. But so tongue and pulse is definitely something that I never did before. And I still don't feel like I'm that great at that. But, you know, I try. Anyway,
I looked at a chart of a tongue at one point with Chinese medicine, and I'm like, oh my gosh, that seems difficult.
Well, you know, for people, you can really learn a lot with just the pictures, you know, just go, yeah, you really can. But the tongue tells a lot. And you know, so tongue and pulse, those are things on the physical diagnosis. But I still use the same, you know, x-rays or blood work and Now, you know, the thing is, if somebody said, look, I don't want to do any of that. I don't want to do any blood work. I don't want to do any of that. I don't want to do any of those diagnostic things. You could still treat that pet if you did a good history and a good physical diagnosis. You can still use Chinese medicine and Western medicine because you can use things that you don't discern on blood work. Blood work sometimes, you know, send you in a direction, but you might already be going in that direction anyway, possibly.
So skin, coat, eyes, ears, like everything holistic.
We all check all of that. There's just a few things, you know, a good veterinarian looks at all of those things. I mean, the people I work with, they look at all of those things, but I don't know, they tongue and pulse and some of those other like little things. The other thing you can do is you can touch acupuncture points for sensitivity and that sort of thing. That's something that's a little different. And kind of, you know, paying attention to just putting the pieces together a little bit differently. You know, I a lot of times will use a Chinese diagram. You know, there's a pentagram that we use in Chinese medicine that a lot of people know, you know, where, you know, you have the fire, the elements, the fire element, the earth element, the metal element, the water element, and the wood element. And sometimes I do that. And then I'll put like, okay, so this dog is diarrhea. This dog has tumors. They belong to the earth element. So I stick them there. This dog has conjunctivitis, eyes, you know, that goes into liver. But the cornea, I mean, the retina, that goes with your kidneys or your water element. So I kind of itchy skin, lung problems, you know, those go to the metal element. And also I might make a constitutional, you know, if it's somebody that's coming for a holistic appointment, I have more time. So I'll think about like what constitution their dog is, you know, whether it's a fire dog or a wood dog or a, you know, and it's just a piece of the puzzle. And a lot of dogs are a combination. Like my dog is a fire dog, you know. But there are some dogs that like are like they're yappy, but they're a little woody. They'll bite you, you know. Yeah. But there's some they'll never bite you, like a true earth element dog, like you know that's like a lab or a golden. A lot of them, you can't generalize though. But
no.
They'll just got like they're just cool. They're not in your face though. But a dog that never leaves you alone, it's in your face and pet me, pet me, pet me. That's a fire dog. So. They might have more issues with their heart. You know, the fire element's associated with heart disease, small intestinal disease, certain things they may not. And Shen disturbance, which is your mental state, that's part of that element. So a lot of times things really fit together. It's super cool. You know, you'll go, does your dog do that?
And
they go, yeah. You know, it works. Yeah. It helps. It's the putting the pieces together in a different way. Is that's what I've learned, you know, from Chinese medicine and I do Western herbal medicine too. I'm taking a class right now with David Winston. David Winston, one of the kings of herbal kings, you know, just amazing. And so I'm taking a 2-year class with him. And it mostly focuses on people, but a lot of the information is applicable to animals too. But I'm learning way more about the herbs than I ever did before. They used to be just names to me, unless I grew them. You know, they were names like Romania, you know, or Chinese coptis, or some of these things. You know, Oregon grapefruit. I heard of them, but I didn't really have a sense of them. Mm-hmm. And it takes forever. It's a lifetime. You know, It's like being a gardener, you know, a name of a plant, but until you grow it and you taste and you see how it looks through all the seasons, you don't really know it. It's like anything, really, knowing anything takes a long time.
It does take a long time. We're all individuals too. And, you know, I can imagine. And as I'm hearing you, and I've looked at Chinese medicine, the elements, which, wow, I mean, I would love to dig in. Like, you have that. I know
it's not that hard.
My golden lake was was fire. I mean, there's just no doubt. And my golden Charlie is definitely not fire. I forget if he came across two. I think he crosses two different ones of elements.
A lot of them.
Is totally fire. You would have enjoyed him. Oh my goodness. But
yeah.
It's exciting to just be able to think of our dogs in those ways, and that you have that knowledge to be able to help assess. I mean, it's awesome. It sounds like in your appointments then, people would feel comfortable sharing maybe a little bit more and not just listening. There sounds like there's a lot of give and take and respectful dialogue about what they're willing to listen to or do. I mean, it does take a leap for folks, I think, now that they're ready for that, and that they may take a different treatment approach, and you're speaking about it and they're going, yeah, let's do it. Like, how is it pretty, are they ready when they hear, are they?
Well, you know what? I work in a regular practice.
Yeah.
And most of my appointments are just not any different than anybody else's. They're, you know, my dog has got diarrhea. My dog has got this. So I might look at the dog in a different way. But I don't always. So what I do my norm, I do the same thing pretty much all the time. And then what I do, and if I see, if it's somebody that I know, like some people make appointments and I know that's what they want, or I know from years of working with them that's what they, you know, they prefer to use an herbal remedy rather than a pharmaceutical if they could. But I still use all that other stuff, of course, all the time. But anyway, if a dog has diarrhea, and I might say, well, you know, we could use metronidazole, or if you want to try, we can try something else, you know, there. And so if they say, yeah, I'd like to try something else, or what do you think, or what would you do if it were your dog?
Yes.
Like, did surgery on my dog.
Yeah.
And I think we gave her, I think she might have had a dose of, you know, carprofen. But I gave her, before we started, she had arnica for a day or so. She wanted to see arnica. And she had that, like, I think maybe 24 hours. And then after it, I kept giving her arnica. And then in the middle of the night, she was a little huffy. So I gave her a dose of Dr. Winston's Aspiria compound. And that's all I did. She didn't get any, and I didn't put her on antibiotics. And even when she opened up her incision, bad dog.
Oh, little girl. Well,
I just warm compressed it, and I put an herbal combination on her wound, and I didn't give her antibiotics because that's what I do, you know, mostly, you know, now.
Yeah.
So there are ways going about. So I might tell somebody if they could go that way if they wanted to, but some people do and some people don't. And I try really hard not to make people feel bad about whatever they choose to do. I mean, because even when people smoke around their pets, I try to be nice about it, to let them know that it's not the best thing. I try not to make them feel bad because, no, I don't want them to feel bad. I just want them to be, I want to educate them. That's what doctor means. It means teacher. That's what the word means. So that's kind of how I look at myself. I think of myself as a teacher and a partner with them. And, you know, I want my clients to feel comfortable. I've had so many clients come to me and I don't even do anything different. I give them vaccines. I do the same thing anybody else would do, but they don't feel bad. I didn't yell at them. I've had so many people come in and say, you know, they were worried about this or that, and their other doctor wouldn't even talk to them about it. And I feel real, you know, I said, you know, your other doctor's a really good doctor. You you're not comfortable talking to them. But that's something you could fix. I try to make them understand so that they understand our role and everything, and that they should be able to talk to us and be able to be honest and not feel bad or guilty or whatever, because none of us do the perfect thing. You know,
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. And I will tell you, in my role with what I've done with my business, that I do hear from pet parents who quietly and confidentially will let me know that they felt belittled, scolded if they didn't give 7 vaccines in an appointment. And I try not to hit them and I try to listen and talk them down.
That's my religion.
Yes. Yes. And so I try to talk them down and I say, you need to find someone else. And they sometimes are just so, you know, they lose their thoughts when they're in there in an appointment. And later there's a lot of regret. They come into I can't believe I just did this to my dog. Why did I do this? And how did your vet present that? Was it a risk reward discussion? How did you decide this? Or if they bring up titering, there are strong reactions. And I say, talk them down off the ledge and say, okay, that happened. Now forward, please consider changing your practice. Yeah. And unfortunately, Dr. Moran, it's happening a lot, I would say. So your refreshing approach is really what's needed. To help people have that empowerment to say, I'm the representative for my dog's wellness. I need to understand the situation. If I understand the risk reward in my particular case, then I'll make a better judgment. And so I'm so happy to hear you speak about that.
Yeah, that's what I try to do. And I think the other doctors in our practice do that too. We hardly ever give a gigantic pile of stuff at once.
I saw the invoice and I just about...
Yeah. Yeah, no,
Well,
there's actual research now, you know, there's a lot of folks that won't do anything. I mean, if they don't have a blind study, they won't believe the sun is out. You know what I mean?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
That'll make me insane, you know, like,
yes, I do.
Why don't we spend money on things that aren't like a no brainer, but anyway, so there is research that say that more than 2 vaccinations at once is associated with increased harm. Now, you know, there are times I gave a chihuahua once 3 vaccines. It was leaving for like a trip and they couldn't go without they were taking the dog before the show or something. Yeah. It nearly killed me to do it, but she was fine. So what I do, and I think the other doctors that I work with do too, we talk about just spacing them out. We do a lot of spacing out. We may do the same protocol, but we just space it out. It's not, most people are happy with that. Some people, it's more difficult for them to come back. So we just talk, but I think they feel better, you know, having a choice. And, you know, some people always they're doing the same things they've always done. And I always say, well, you know, next year your dog's going to be a little older. Maybe you want to think about doing something a little different next time. It's okay. And there are dogs that are just really probably shouldn't be vaccinated, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. You know, dogs with immune-mediated diseases, dogs with cancer, dogs with chronic disease. And sometimes they'll come in and they're a little sick. And I always say, listen, why don't we wait? Because I don't know what's going on here. And maybe this is just a bump in the road. And your dog's going to be fine or your cat's going to be fine. But if I vaccinate them, and this has happened to me already. I mean, you know, with cats that had upper respiratory infections. Mm-hmm. I remember she lived in Schuylkill County. She kept coming like, can I get her vaccinated today? No,
you can't.
No. Oh, and I just felt so bad, but I just, you know, I just couldn't. I just thought because I've had some come in, they were a little sniffly. The owner said, you know, just go ahead and give it. And they've come back and they've been sicker. You know, not does it always happen? No. Most of the time they're fine. But I you know, if somebody says, what do you think is the best thing? I have clients that say, no, I want to just go ahead and do it. And if they do, I just, you know, unless it's really terrible risk, I do it. And you know, most of the time they're fine. But I'm responsible. It's my hand squirting that stuff in.
Yep.
So I know, at least as far in my heart, that I'm not doing wrong. You know what I mean?
So knowing do no harm has always been something for
me. And it's
tough
because there are times when people choose not to vaccinate their pets. And there are people I said, no. You have to, I think. Or I would recommend that you do. Like somebody that doesn't want to vaccinate their cats for panleukopenia. Mm-hmm. You know, when you see cats get cat distemper and die from it, in my lifetime, I've seen them die from that. I've seen them die from parvo.
Yeah.
Used to love parvo. I'm not going to let somebody's dog go out running around in the world without a parvo vaccine.
Yep.
I think that that's throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
Yeah.
So I think there's a place for vaccines, and there's also abuse of vaccines, in my opinion, you know, and I think, you know, there's, I think that vaccinations are always a tricky subject because it's an intrinsically tricky subject in human medicine and everywhere. And I think there's a lot of misinformation. There's a lot of
fear
stuff that gets in the way. So I think it's not, I think it's if you stay on a one-to-one looking at this patient away from broad generalizations and just say, let's just think about your dog and what your dog's life is like, you know, and your cat's life is like, and let's think about what they're likely to need. And, you know, there's a risk either way, you know, if you want to have leptospirosis or Lyme disease. I wish that you could vaccinate for everything, that I could just give all these vaccines and they would be completely innocuous.
Yes.
If I could wrap them up in innocuous pharmaceutical bubble wrap, I would do it. But in my mind, it's not innocuous. I know it's not. In my gut, it feels like, you know, so I, you know, that's why, and it takes a lot of extra time to talk about that. And some people really want to hear that whole spiel. And other people, I know they're you know, they're like, will she shut up? I'm going to get out of here.
Shot.
Let me get out of here.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, I hear you.
They go to somebody else.
Yeah, I know. I know.
I got places to go. People see. I want to talk to that long-winded Dr. Moran.
Oh, stop. I'm going to go back
to my Febreze.
I want to go back to a really topic close to your heart, which is herbals. And I know you're a gardener. This woman is so talented. She plays the violin. She's a gardener. Oh, exactly. You do all kinds of, you know, your art and your science in a beautiful blend from what I hear and see. So your herbals and growing them, taking detailed two-year classes. Can you walk us through maybe just some scenarios of health? I had written, you and I had talked about maybe a heart issue or perhaps a kidney or just a case or two where maybe you were
I'll
able to
tell you about those.
Yeah. Can you talk about that? Because that's going to be a different approach than maybe a conventional Western.
So if I have my intro things to herbal medicine was a lot of times you'll see patients come in all the time with heart murmurs. All the time.
Okay.
And cardiologists, God love them, they're really expensive.
Yes.
You know, and every patient that comes into me and has a heart murmur, I always say, you know, I'd like you to go see a cardiologist so we know how serious this is.
Yes.
Now, sometimes they really have cardiac disease. You know that they do. And it's an easier sell. What I always tell people is try to find where they're going to be. Like they have dog shows and, you know, try to find them there. And you can sometimes get an appointment and it's much less money. And so that's one way sometimes they can go. But most people, you know, six or whatever, $100 that for somebody that's asymptomatic, doesn't have any issues at their heart. You know, there, I think, well, maybe there's something you could do. So we have, so there's different products that we have that, and there's a lot of heart support things out there. One of the things I like a lot is hawthorn are the berries and flowers and, you know, leaves from the hawthorn tree. And they are what Dr. Winston calls an atropho restorative, which is there are a lot of plants that are really just paired with an organ in the sense that they are, tropho means to build, I think, I don't know, restorative, bring something back. But anyway, they're just good food. They're food. for an organ. So a tropo restorative for the heart is hawthorn. So I use a lot of Dr. Winston's hawthorn berry paste, which tastes delicious, and a lot of dogs will eat it. I use some supplements that are like cardiac support, like by standard process. And there's other companies that make, and they have just good things for your heart. Now, are they going to fix it? I don't know. I mean, there are people that, one of my clients told me she had a dog with a heart problem. She started giving hawthorn, like a tincture with hawthorn and some other things. And it really, really like fixed what was going on. Now, I think that's possible depending on what's going on. But I think what I'm hoping for, at least in these instances, is to hold things, you know, still at least. And yeah. So, you know, so things like coenzyme Q10 and sometimes some amino acids, there's a lot of different things that you can do that are supportive to the heart or other organs, like so tropo restorative for the kidney is, and this is something that people in the herbal community know, but it was something that Dr. Winston, it's something that he learned. And it's that, and it's a long story. It's his story to tell. It's a cool story, how he learned this, but he uses nettle seed tincture for kidney disease. Now he works on people, a little on animals, but mostly people. And so this is something that he uses in a lot of his kidney protocols. And I don't want to represent anything from someone else.
Right.
But so it's something I learned from him. So if I have a patient that's got kidney disease, I often put them on nettle seed. There's a, you know, astragalus is a Chinese herbal that's wonderful for the kidneys, and cordyceps, which is a mushroom, really, really good for helping the kidneys work better. There are formulas, you know, that are kidney supportive. They're kind of easy peasy, you know, Romania 6, Romania 8. They're not, you know, most herbal formulas that I use are, you know, the worst that can happen is you might get diarrhea. There's some of them that have stronger components, but in general, the ones I use, if you dumped a bottle of Rimadyl out and your dog ate, they'd be in deep manure. But if they ate a bottle of Romania 6, they might get diarrhea, you know, like,
yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Of course.
They're just more benign, but in that, you know, they also, so those are things that you can do to be supportive. And of course, food, I mean, we always talk about food because the better food you eat, the better. So I always tell all my clients that in my opinion, the best diet is either a home cooked diet or a raw diet, or you can, you know, some of the raw diets you can cook a little bit, you know, because they're not there's no one size fits all with food either.
Nope.
But a lot of people, you know, that sort of thing isn't in their budget or whatever. So I say you can do a little bit. You can make a little stew. You can make a meat and a vegetable and a green vegetable. And as long as you're adding that to a well-balanced, well-made, you know, dry or canned food, you're not going to mess them up too much. But you know, it's better to feed a well-made dry dog food than to make some cockamamie recipe that's not well-balanced.
Yes,
and feed it continually. Because you can really, depending on their age, you know, if it's a large breed growing dog and you start feeding it a bunch of meat and they're not on a really good dry dog food too, or whatever, canned food too, you know, mess them up big time.
Bones, minerals. Yeah.
Yeah. They mess them up. So anyway.
Yeah.
And
I talk
about their environment, you know, their environment and their emotional state.
Yes.
And my clients if they can, you know, we talk about training and sit, stay down. And I think dogs need a lot more. They're kids, basically, in my opinion. That whole alpha dog thing is malarkey. I think it's our relationship to them is parental. And I think if you're a good parent to your kids, or not good, but you know what I mean. If you know how to train children, you can train dogs. It just
makes positivity, without fear.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. You don't want to be afraid. You get mad sometimes, but you let it go. You don't hold a grudge.
Yes.
You spend time with them. You love them. You give them what they need. And you think about what they need so much, not so much what you need. You have to take a, but I think too, I always tell people to please think about themselves, because I have had clients do things for their pets that I think are too much for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're sacrificing too much of their time, too much of their money, too much of their emotional energy. And you can't go down with the ship, because you do have real life kids and real life husbands and real life mortgages. So I don't like people to hawk their soul.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, totally do. And that can be like a rabbit hole. Yes. And then their emotional state is so wrapped up and they're anxious, it goes right down to the dog. And then we can't get any kind of stasis. Like, we can't get a point of, here we are, we're going to only do this for a period of time. They get very down it. And it's hard. You just want to make them feel better so that they feel better. Yeah.
I never want anybody to feel guilty, you know?
No.
Because we can't, everybody's, and I think that's a big part of what I always try to get people, is that everybody has a different, you know, we're always comparing ourselves to other people in so many ways all the time. And somebody sees somebody else going off. And I mean, one of my clients got a heart valve replacement. They went to France. They got their dog heart valve replacement.
Wow. Yeah.
They spent like, you know, but the man said, you know what? I can do it. I have that money. I can do it.
Yeah.
And it, you know, but
and he wasn't stressed. He wasn't stressed. He could do it.
He did.
They took a trip.
Owed some money and they spent their dog. And, you know, and that's wonderful. But I wouldn't want, with other people, you know, sometimes I think they go, I worry about them going too far.
Yes, I understand.
And so we have to be compassionate to ourselves as well, and try not to feel guilty that we can't. And even if I try not to let people know this, but I really do think that we do give our dogs some of our garbage. And I don't think that we should feel guilty about it. It's an awareness thing. It's the same thing with your kids. You know, if you come home crazy, it's gonna roll downhill to them. So it's all, and it's just like, I work in a vet office. If I come in a crabby mood, I could transfer that old black spot, you know, Treasure Island and the black spot. You can give that to somebody else. And you don't feel guilty about it. It's just a good idea to be aware of it.
Very much so.
To work on it. We have to forgive ourselves when we snap at people.
Which will happen. And we know, like, oh, I wish they would do this.
Like, knock it off. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That throws up all over the rug. You know, I think a little bit of anger is like, I mean, it's natural, right? You don't beat up, but you go, ugh.
Yeah. No.
Step
very
on that
wise.
Hairball first thing in the morning, right?
Wise words. Wise words. Such wise words. Yeah. Very much everything you say, as far as how it all works together, and your approach in this integrative approach. I know there's many cases where we could integrate, and even people to know that osteoarthritis or even dental. There's all kinds of medical conditions that your dogs may have that this integrative approach can really help. And the other thing I think it's important that you're saying, and it was for me, so it's a personal journey, was that once I really needed an integrative plan for the cancer of hemangiosarcoma, I didn't want to go out there. I do a lot of research, but I'm not good enough, you know, and I didn't want to start shooting darts. And I do see that people grab and then they go do it for 2 weeks and then they grab something else. And so for me, I said, I need professionals in integration and cancer care to help me with the protocol, because, you know, I do good research. I do think I do, but for folks listening in this area, I believe you need someone like Dr. Moran, someone like Dr. Sarah Urban. I use. There's other wonderful integrative.
Yeah, Lee Simpson.
Let them know and help you with your plan so that when you finally think, I don't think this is working, like, what am I missing? And you spoke to me about that. Some of the herbals are contradictory to each other. They are not helpful, or there might be an ingredient in one of those that's undoing something that you're working on. So just a caution to viewers out there that while some things can be easily taken, when it gets complex or in any kind
of
way,
it's hard for me.
Yeah, you got to have someone who really has the bigger picture.
Yeah, and it's hard. You know, I've been doing this kind of medicine since 2008.
Yeah,
but I have one of my friends who was in the vet school class behind. She was a valedictorian at the class behind me.
Wow,
she's been doing this for a lot longer. So that it's a, you know, so when some of the things that she's been able to do with her therapies, I look at them and go, oh my gosh, you know, So I'm not, you know, I'm not an expert. I'm still learning tons of things, and beware the doctor who says they know everything.
Yeah.
Run the other direction, you know, because none of us know everything, but there's an awful lot. It's a whole lifetime of learning. You know, I do acupuncture and I feel like I've been doing it for a while, but there are people that all they do is acupuncture, and it's a lifetime of learning all of these things. And so I'm constantly going to classes and courses and workshops and learning new things and bringing them home. And, you know, it scrambles your brain for a while because you think, oh my gosh, this and that. So, but you pick the things that seem to work and common sense, and you try them, and you know that there's some things you're going to help with. There's some things you may not. I feel that one of the best things to do, and I think it's one of the best things that people do whenever they take their pet to any veterinarian, is that they are trying to do something for them.
Yeah.
And they don't want to just give up. They want to have some peace of mind, you know. So sometimes we spend $300 on blood work for peace of mind.
Yes.
And we just find out what we already kind of knew, but they feel like feel better. And some people really need that. Other people don't need it as much. I find that some of my clients that have had animals forever, I mean, many, 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 many of them, some of them are, you know, they sort of see the writing on the wall on some things. They've seen it before. They know there's not much. But, you know, I always say, well, we can try this as long as you're breathing. There's still things you can try, as long as the patient as long as you're helping relieve the suffering. So if there's suffering I always say there's my three things. If you can't breathe, if you can't fix somebody's breathing problems, if you can't fix their pain or unrelenting nausea, it's time to go.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, nobody wants to live with unrelenting pain.
Mm-hmm.
You know, trying like this and see how it feels to be a pug.
Yes. Yes.
Or, you know, you can't breathe or, you know, I'm hardly ever nauseous, but I know that if I had that, I wouldn't want to live with that.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things that you can help to ameliorate and help pain and all those things. But when you stop being able to help, then, you know, it's time to say goodbye. And I think that's always a hard place to get, you know. And I think there's sometimes people come in thinking that herbs are, you know, they're not medicine. They're magic. They're not medicine. And they are kind of magic. I really think if there's anything magical in the world, it's plants. You know, there's a lot of magic in plants. I mean, I can't say enough for herbal medicine. I mean, plants, you take an herb for something and it goes in. And I always, this is my analogy of, like, there's some plants that are what we call amphoteric. In other words, and a lot of mushrooms are like that. They go in and say, they come in. It's like somebody coming over, a really good friend will come in and knock at the door and say, what do you need? I'll do whatever you want. But some people will come in and go, I'm cleaning your house. I'm doing the dishes. And you go, no, I really don't want, I really want lunch. You know? So a mushroom will come in and it'll make you lunch. It won't assume you need. So they're amphoteric. In other words, they can, and there are herbs and that are what we call immune amphoterics. They come in and they just try to make the immune system work better. They don't suppress it. They don't stimulate it. They just make it work better. They are, I don't know any drugs that do that.
That's awesome.
They stimulate. They can stimulate your immune system. They can suppress it. But to make it work better, I don't know anything that does that.
Yeah.
That's why.
We did turkey tail for hemangio with University of Penn studies, and it's been a magical mushroom for many dogs.
Yeah.
On this note, do you believe it? Our hour is up. We're up. I knew we would do this.
Yeah.
Tell folks how to find you, and I'm hoping that you'll come back again to the show. Tell folks how to find you if they want to see you.
Okay. Well, I'm at Willow Creek Veterinary Center, which is, you know, easy to find. We're still doing appointments with the COVID thing. And we clients call in and I talk to them on the phone. This is how most of us do. We talk on the phone and try to get an idea of what's going on. And then the pets come in with our techs and we examine them. And then we come up with a plan and we implement the plan and keep in contact with the clients pretty much over the phone. Sometimes we go outside and talk to them, but mostly it's on the phone. So things are kind of slower than usual, although I'm slower. I take more time just because of my nature. I mean, you know, obviously I can talk, you know, anyway. So a lot of times I don't always have tons of open space. So I'm happy to see anybody if they can fit them in my schedule. I'd be happy to see them. And, you know, but there's a, sometimes it's hard. Like somebody will say, I can't get in with you. So Understand that. I said, well, you know, let them know and maybe I can find a hole someplace. But, you know, it's sometimes like a shoehorn trying to, and the same thing with all of our doctors, because we're busy, you know, we're so busy right now, but that's how you find me. And,
have a lot more coming now after today's,
I don't walk on water, you know, I don't, I'm just going to come in and, you know,
no.
You know what I mean? As you said, I always tell my clients, they forgot to give me the magic wand and the crystal ball when I graduated, you know.
I really think
sometimes, you know, people have unrealistic expectations, but sometimes things you don't expect to happen do happen. So you just have to go with the flow. You do your best. I think the most important thing is have an open mind.
That's
as a doctor.
Beautiful.
Off the air.
Oh. So you and I are talking.
We're done.
Time to off the air.
Great. Sorry. Okay. We're done.
So we are still talking.
You and I are so done. But you're awesome. I knew you would be so awesome. So hopefully
you'll now I can say political bad things.
Yeah.
Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.